This is Stuart McPherson, speaking from a crowded briefing room of an advanced fighter-bomber station of the Tactical Air Force. The briefing room is in a Nissen hut, and in a great many ways is exactly like any other briefing room. At the front of the room are huge operational maps showing everything there is to know of enemy-occupied territory, particularly the coastal stretches. On two parts of the largest map are two attractive pin-up girls cut out from a popular magazine. Familiar parts of flying gear hang sloppily on the walls. Two or three beds where the Air Force and Army intelligence officers sleep are being used to accommodate some of the flyers who are streaming in through a small door to my right. Quite some minutes ago, I thought that it would be impossible to get any more men in this room, but still they come, all wearing battle dress, many of them carrying maps in their boot tops, most of them with thick, warm-looking sweaters rolled up to their neck. The squadrons I'm going to watch being briefed are Canadians, the youngest Canadian squadrons in the RCAF. They are commanded by an English wing commander, an outstanding fighter ace of the RAF with many kills to his credit and wearing the ribbons of the DSO and DFC on his tunic. One of the squadrons is led by an American who joined the RAF at the outbreak of war and has stayed on with them since that time. There's rather a tense atmosphere in the room, for the lads are certain that, as they say, this is it. But they're laughing and talking as they tumble in from outside. They joke and jostle each other. Those unable to find a seat try all sorts of schemes in their effort to get somewhere to sit down. One of the lads has taken advantage of the stove in the center of the room and is straddled across it with his arms draped around the pipe. And now the commanding officer, the young RAF wing commander, has come in, and in a few minutes these young flyers will hear the briefing that they've been waiting 4 years to hear. Their orders to provide air cover for the armies of liberation. And now the wing commander will be giving information that is of value to the enemy as well as to his own flyers, so naturally we can't record that. But we are going to record his opening remarks to the flyers. And now he's ready, they're all quieting down, and we'll listen to the wing commander.
Okay, everybody. Well, this is it, boys. Tomorrow's the big show. D-Day is tomorrow. And H-Hour, when the American and our own forces go into the continent, is sometime early tomorrow morning. Now, our job tomorrow and for the succeeding few days is to maintain a complete air superiority over this assault area here so that the Army and the Navy can get on with their job and sort of get on and establish a beachhead, bridgehead, and go right on unmolested.
Following those simple, quiet remarks, the wing commander went on to give out the general plan to his young chicks, as he called them. The briefing over, the flyers filed out, still chatting, still joking among themselves, but grimmer than when they first came into the hut. These fighter pilots do not look on this job as adventurous, gay, or romantic. To them, it is a grim job of work that has to be done, and done thoroughly. They want to get back to doing the things in life they want to do. Take in a cricket game, take a girl to the movies when they want to, live their own life. And as I watch them file out of that briefing, I think that they are a good bet to do just that thing.